It all started with a sample. It was this, I was browsing through these records and I stumbled upon this drum and bass record. And I heard this sound, kind of a hoover. I was like, whoa, I really like the sound. And so I cut it out of the record and started working with sample. And from that point, at some point, I had a little bit made of the record, really premature. And I was like, I really like it. And so I went downstairs where Marlon was, our studio was on the upper floor. And I said to him, dude, you gotta come listen. I think I've made something really cool. So yeah, he walked upstairs and from that point he heard it and he was like, dude, it's actually really cool.
When you had the first sketch of the track, we still had to come up with a breakdown. And we did it the same day. Yeah. And what I also really like about Mush Mush, it's one of the first tracks that had a breakdown which was a little bit trancey, like the big chords, but in like a house record. And then I think at some point we also had this thing, we called it like trouse, or Tiesto trance called it trouse, yeah. Like trance house, because it's like a trance breakdown, and but it was like a 128 kind of house groove kind of track, but in the breakdown it was trance. So it was like, this was like all new, it didn't really exist yet. Maybe that's also why it became such a big festival track.
Eventually we sent the track to Thijs and he really liked the track. But he immediately came with feedback and he said, if you alter these parts, it will be amazing and then we could release it on Musical Freedom. It was actually the pre-dub bar, which is maybe 1 point somewhat seconds, which I just couldn't get right. And I maybe worked on it 3 weeks before I got it right. For that track, it was the right pre-dub and it works.
At the time we had the track ready, we still had a lot of shows in Holland, in the Netherlands. And every time I played it, it was just too much of a hard, it was too hard, it was too big room, as to say. We played all the like small clubs, but it was a track made for the festival, so it didn't really necessarily work as well for the crowds we were playing for. At some point, it was EDC in Las Vegas, and I got a text message from someone that was at the festival, and they're like, dude, I heard Mush Mush 6 times on the main stage today at this festival. And that's kind of like when I was like, okay, this is a big track.
We discussed remaking Mush Mush quite a few times, but we never got to it or didn't see the right moment, or the moment wasn't fit to do it. But obviously, releasing our album, the biggest, what better way to celebrate the album than to re-scope your own first big room track for this album. We try to in essence keep that thing which makes Mush Mush. Like for instance, the first build-up, it's I think still 80% the same as it was, because that's so defining for that track. And the drops actually still the same, but it's just a new developed sound. Get down.
I was playing the Musical Freedom Party at Club Air, and I had to play after Tiesto, but I think the last time that I was in the DJ booth with Tiesto was like the Ibiza days, which was right after the release of Mush Mush. And this is funny because I always have the set like planned out a little bit in my head, and we had like a track that we always start our intro with, but then it turned out that he wanted me to like mix into his last track to take over the set. And I'm like, hey, wait a minute, we just have the first version done of Mush Mush, let's complete this circle, I'm gonna mix in the new Mush Mush. So he heard it for the first time too. He's like, whoa, this is cool. Yeah, that was also like a trip back in time, because that's how it started. That's how, when everything changed.
We never were dreaming about making an album or such. We just always fun is a really important factor in what we're doing. What we didn't like was when our favorite artist making an album and they started to experiment or redefine themselves as an artist. Well, we were, okay, we like you as an artist as you were. We want to hear more of it and the same but better maybe. So then we set out to make a big room album, sort of kind of like festival experience. You could just turn it on and have this experience at home, and it's actually more in depth, more in detail big room music, as you know actually. And I think that's the fun part of making this album. For me, it's a big room 2.0.
I never really saw before like the value of doing an album. I was more like, it's better to do singles so every track gets the right attention. But in this case, the album like complements, the tracks complement each other. I didn't even really realize it until the album got actually like released and I took the time to listen on Spotify myself. I want to see what the real listener experience like. You go on Spotify, you turn on the album. So I wanted to see the transitions and everything, if everything was right. And I'm like, oh, this is actually really cool. This is like, this is like a festival experience right here at home.
We never set the goal too far. It's just always baby steps and evolving then rather than revolutionizing. And I think that's a very healthy way to progress. And the next step is making vocals cool again and big.